welcome everyone that's going to watch online. This teaching is called Afikomen to Communion. And so basically I'm I'm jumping sheep. The sheep are jumping sheep. I'm piggybacking off of last week's message. And we're going to talk about how, so last week we talked about the Quarto Deciman controversy. And I mentioned on Wednesday that I met a pastor 2 miles from here. He's got a Seventh-day Church of God congregation. He came here on Wednesday and we talked. He's 60 years old. And they've been up there for years, just connected. And here's what he said. We started talking about the Sabbath, and I said, do you keep the feasts? Now listen, this is Wednesday. We just learned about Quarto Deciman on Sabbath. I said, do you keep the feasts? He said, I'm Quarto Deciman. And I was like, well, praise the Lord. I know what that means. Most people would have no clue what that even means. It means he does Passover on the 14th day of the first month. And if you were here last week, if you weren't here last week, go watch the teaching. It's up on YouTube about what we're talking about, the Quarto Deciman controversy. And just to really quickly tell you that Yeshua trained the apostles, and then the apostles had disciples. And we have writings from those men that were trained by the apostles, Polycarp being one of them. In Polycarp's writings, he said that Yeshua told John to tell him that they were supposed to keep Passover on the 14th day and not deviate, no matter what men would say. You can't change the Sabbath and the feast days. Amen. That's out there in writing. So we talked about that. But what I'm going to share with you today proves my point from last week that mainstream Protestant pastors and denominations either haven't studied Quarto Deciman controversy or they're covering it up. We're going to look at an actual article from one of the biggest names in the church, and we're just going to read his words at the end, and I'm going to show you that he really doesn't know this part of history, which is... be thankful that you know. Okay? Be thankful. So from the days of Yeshua until the year 325, the apostles in the early church kept Passover on the 14th day of the first month. That's a scriptural and historical fact. Okay? Right? Everybody smile. But today most Christians don't observe Passover. Instead, they observe Easter. Right? We know that. We used to do Easter. Another interesting shift, and this is what we're going to focus on today, in so-called apostolic tradition, also happened at the same time. And this is what we're going to talk about. This is our topic for today. Today we're going to explore the ordinance of communion. We've all taken communion before we did Passover. Raise your hand if you've taken communion. We've all taken communion. Ken came from a church that does it every Sunday. Or any time they get together, doesn't have to be a Sunday. If you meet, you're doing communion. But what most don't realize is that when you take the communion, your little cup, you know, like we in the Assemblies of God, we got the little clear cup, right? And you just take it, you know. Then what most don't know is that's the final part of the Passover Seder. It's the last thing you do when you have Passover. Most Christian pastors, teachers, and theologians believe that during the Last Supper, which Rabbi Joe taught me to call the Last Seder, thought that was pretty bad. It's a little bit better because it uses the word Seder. But the Last Supper, most Protestant leaders believe that Yeshua was setting aside Passover and instituting communion. They honestly, in their heart, believe that that last Passover was the last one we're ever going to do. And then some will say, well, because he said do it again, they say, well, when he comes back, then it will be reinstituted. So there's two schools of thought. One, he totally did away with it forever. One, he did away with it in this gap, and then he's going to bring it back during the millennium. So I've studied this for years, and then again, this week I began to look at it again. I've studied what mainstream Protestant denominations, what their doctrines have to say on this subject, and so what I'm going to share with you today is what most teach, okay? So we know Passover is the 14th day of the first month. We know that it happens between the evenings, right? Sun is setting. There's a little window. Then it gets dark. In the window of when it's not completely dark, that's called between the evenings. That's when you start Passover. By the time Passover's over, you're moved into the 15th day, which is a high Sabbath. Everybody understand all that so far? We know that Passover is a teaching meal. It's not just a meal. This was instituted by God, that the way we keep this feast is by celebrating a community meal. And the leader, the head of the table or the leader, teaches while we walk through all the elements of Passover. The Passover tells two stories, both of redemption. One is Moses and one is Yeshua. There are three essentials in every Passover: bitter herbs, unleavened bread, and lamb. And that's Passover in a nutshell, really quick. Most of you know these. I'm doing this, these next several slides, I'm doing this for people that don't know. So I understand y'all know, but we're reaching a lot of people that have not heard this, okay? So we know in Leviticus 23 that the Bible lays out the feasts. And it says, the Lord Yahweh spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, the feasts of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations, these are my feasts. The feasts of Yahweh, holy convocations, which you proclaim at their appointed times. So right there, they're God's feast days, and we're to keep them, right? I've retranslated it using the word feast is actually a appointment, and holy convocation is a rehearsal to worship. The Lord Yahweh spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, the appointments of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy rehearsals to worship God. These are my appointments. These are the appointments of Yahweh, holy rehearsals to worship God. And if we just take the literal definition of feast and holy convocations, that changes how we understand Leviticus. Just a simple thing like saying, what is feast? It's an appointment, right? So the first point is, the feasts are times when God says, I want to meet with you, and we're supposed to show up and meet with him, right? We all know that. We're here. Sabbath is a feast, right? It's a moed. Then we read about Passover. Passover is on the 14th day of the first month at twilight. That's between the evenings. It's the Lord's Passover. So whose Passover is it? It's not the Jewish people's. It's not Moses's. It's the Lord's. And on the 15th day of the month is unleavened bread. And we do that to the Lord. And then it says in Exodus 12, this day, Passover, will be a memorial for you. It's a feast. It's an appointment to the Lord. And then this part here, this is why, everybody listen, this next sentence, this next part of the sentence is why the Quarto Decimum controversy began to surface. What does it say? The 14th day, Quarto Decimum, 14th day of the first month is Passover. It's supposed to be done, when Moses instituted it, throughout your generations. So what started happening was men wanted to change the ordinances of God. Polycarp, in his generation, was the spokesman for the congregations that he was the He was the bishop. He oversaw all the congregations, and he taught them, we keep Passover, we do the feast. This was in the year 160. So when we get to the doctrines of Protestant theologians that say as soon as Yeshua, the night he had his Passover, he changed everything, and we're going to read a big name teacher that influences millions, and their doctrine says that, it makes me really question why they don't understand the quartil decimum controversy, or why have they covered it up. Something's not right. Does everybody understand? Yeah. Quartil decimum controversy. Polycarp versus Anicetus, I think was his name. The Roman bishop versus the Yeshua bishop. And they met. And the churches of Rome that he was overseeing wanted to change Passover and bring in Easter. Polycarp said, John told me I'm not to change no matter what you say. And so the first church split happened. Some men went to Easter, some went to kept Passover and the feasts. And then there's this argument that, well, listen, Passover is for the Jews, even though it don't say it. That's what they say. Well, I'm going to read just a few scriptures to refute that. For 7 days, no leaven will be found in your house, since whoever eat what is leavened, that same person will be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he's a stranger, non-Jew, or whether he's a native. So if Passover isn't for the sojourners, why does it say it is for the sojourners? And my point is, Passover is for all of Israel, and Israel has always, since Mount Sinai, been biological sons and adopted sons. Does that make sense? Once they went to Mount Sinai, those that were married became sons of Israel. Numbers 15 says the same thing. If a stranger dwells with you, or whoever is among you throughout your generations, this is talking to the biological sons of Israel, and they want to present an offering made by fire, a sweet aroma to the Lord, just like you do, so shall he do. He shall worship me just like you do. That's just a little paraphrase. Does everybody understand, right? Say one. Ordinance will be for you of the assembly, that's the biological sons, and for the stranger that dwells with you. This, follow me, is an ordinance, how long? Until Yeshua comes? Throughout your generations. So we've got a problem if we change these things. One custom and one law for you and the stranger. Another scripture says in Deuteronomy, all of you stand here before the Lord. All of the people were assembled, and all of the people meant the biological sons and those that came out of Egypt. Because we know a mixed multitude came out, right? So what we learn is there was a whole lot of people with the children of Israel that weren't Israelites. They were adopted, and they have a meeting, and we get to peer into the meeting in this scripture. All of you stand here today before the Lord your God, your leaders, your tribes, your elders, your officers, all the men of Israel, your little ones and your wives, also, say also, the stranger that's in your camp. Now, if we were to look at Ezekiel chapter 37, there's a decree in Ezekiel chapter 37 that says if someone that's not a biological son or daughter of Israel, if they dwell with the children of Israel and they have children in their midst, whatever tribe they're camping with, they become an adopted member of that tribe. So you have Assyrians, and you have different slaves that came out of Egypt, and some are camping with Dan, some are camping with Ephraim, some are camping with whoever. They have sons and daughters, they're called from that tribe. So that's in another place in the Bible. So all these people are there, the strangers, and then he does this. Even your servants, the one that cuts your wood and draws your water. So they would have servants, even those people. Is there a distinction in this next sentence? Listen, that you may enter into covenant, say covenant, with the Lord your God. So we build the case, starting in the Old Testament, that the covenants of God are for the biological and the adopted, the Passover, and all the Torah. There's only one covenant and one covenant people, and that covenant people has strangers and biological sons of Israel, and they have one way to worship God. It's laid out in Leviticus chapter 23. Polycarp knew this. He hung out with John, and John hung out with Yeshua. They knew all these scriptures, family. You understand? So when Rome tries to change it, there's an issue going on. And today, the modern Protestant church, I love you pastors, if you're watching, I love you, but you're daughters of Rome in much of your theology and much of your practice. They have the gospel right. We know that. Listen, you've read this before, I know, but just read with me. You're entering into covenant with the Lord. Who? That's just for the Jews. No, it's not. That he may establish you today as a people. Oh, that's so good. For himself. That's awesome. Oh, that he may be your God. And listen, this is so cool because it fast forwards from this time all the way to us. Listen. I don't just, now everybody's there. It's like, we got a meeting today, meeting. Everybody's there. And then he says, I not just make this covenant with you, but with those that stand here today, as well as those who aren't here today. That means you. Isn't that cool? Because why? It goes throughout your generations. Man, isn't that good? Now this is where Paul builds his theology from. Exodus 12 and 13, Numbers 15, and Deuteronomy 29. For we are his workmanship, created in Yeshua the Messiah for good works, which he prepared beforehand so that we could walk in them. Now listen, remember at one time, that means you can't, listen, this can't be both, like one time and then it still is. This is a pivot. You were at one time Gentiles in the flesh. He doesn't say your fleshly birth changed. He's talking about a spiritual adoption. Do you get it? You're still from whatever. Where are you from? I'm Cherokee and German and mixed up, right? And I got a little leprechaun. I'm probably 25% leprechaun. What? But, when it comes to God, covenants, and spirituality, I am not Gentile. I am an adopted son of Israel. And that changed me. Man, that changed everything about how I saw myself in Scripture, that revelation. Y'all know, y'all got it. It's like, light bulb. Remember your former state, Gentiles by birth, called uncircumcised by those who were merely because of operation in the flesh called circumcised. At that time you had no Messiah. You were estranged. You were estranged. You used to be outside of covenant. What makes you change from Gentile spiritually to a son of Israel spiritually? It's the covenant. Say covenant. And how do we enter into the covenant? The blood of Yeshua. It's not, you can't enter into that covenant based just on Torah. You cannot. You enter into covenant. That's the issue we're having with people that are, they're denying Yeshua and denying Paul, and they still think they're in covenant with God. If you don't have the Son, you don't have the Father, family. You were estranged from the national life of Israel. That means in the Messiah, you're a part of the nation. You were foreigners to the covenants. Now, I like this. Now, the New Living Translation is out there on some stuff. It's very easy to read. Like, if you have somebody that you want to get them a Bible and they're not a Bible reader, you can get them the NLT, New Living Translation. If you want to get literal, you don't need that one. But listen to how they translate this. It's really cool. Don't forget that you Gentiles used to be outsiders. You were called uncircumcised heathens. I like that because it's getting right to it. Like, they're saying the New Living is like, what's really behind what's being said? By the Jews who were proud of their circumcision, even though it affected only their bodies and not their hearts. Isn't that interesting? It is a good translation. For we are his workmanship, created in Yeshua the Messiah for good works, which God prepared beforehand and we should walk in them. Therefore, remember that one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, right? You were alienated from the commonwealth of Israel. You were strangers to the covenants of promise. You didn't have hope, okay? Why did I bring that up? We're going to get to the back to the controversy about Passover and communion, but I wanted to build that because Paul got his theology from those scriptures, Exodus 12 and 13, Numbers 15 and Deuteronomy 29. And Polycarp knew that. Okay? Polycarp would have accepted Paul's writings. You understand? But 2,000 years now, since Polycarp, we've got men who are called leaders of Israel, spiritual Israel is what they call the church, who don't understand these things. You're no longer strangers and aliens, but fellow citizens. That's the adoption. Fellow citizens. Amen? Now here's something. Again, before we get into the other stuff, I've challenged people with this one. Paul actually teaches Torah traditions in the New Testament. I'm going to show you one place, two places, but listen to this. Now we command you, brothers, Paul's writing a letter to the fellowship in Thessalonica. We command you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Yeshua the Messiah, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that does what? And does not follow the tradition, say tradition, which he received from us. So Paul starts this congregation. He teaches things which in the English are called traditions. Then he travels and he gets news that some of the brothers in the fellowship are not following the traditions that Paul laid out when he was there. Does everybody know what, are you awake? You hear what I just said? Paul taught some traditions. He leaves the fellowship. There's people that start breaking the traditions. They write to Paul, let him know. He writes back. He said, listen, if they're not going to follow what I taught you, like, look, Yeshua came straight to me in a vision, told me what to do, then break fellowship. Don't have anything to do with them. That's pretty hard words. So I thought to myself one day, I said, what does the word tradition mean? This word means instructions written. Look, this isn't from any crazy. This is from Strong's definition of the word. Instructions written or given orally, Jewish traditional laws, the Torah. And included in that, listen what this leaves room for. This leaves room for keeping the feast days and having traditions that wouldn't break the commands of God. If you understand what I mean. See, our Jewish brothers have been following the feast for so long. There are traditions that go along with how you celebrate the feast days. And that's what he would have went and set up. So does Paul in this passage teach Torah to the believers? Yes. Okay. Paul's writing again. He says, your glorying is not good. Do you not know a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Therefore, purge out the old leaven that you be a new lump, since you are truly unleavened. For indeed, Christ, Yeshua, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Now listen. Therefore, let us do away with the feast days, now that Yeshua is here. Is that what he says? Let us keep the feasts. And then he says, look, keep the feasts, but do spiritual house cleaning. Not with the old leaven or the leaven of malice. He's saying, look, keep the feasts, but be holy in it. So right here in these two places, Paul's teaching to keep the feasts. The first year I did Passover, it was early in the 2000s. I don't know when. If my wife was here, she could tell you the minute and the hour on the second, what she was wearing, where we were sitting, what color shirt I had on. But I know this. The Lord said, you need to start doing Passover. I said, how? I didn't get any answers. So I thought, I told Jessica, I said, Passover's coming up. We're going to do something, you know. So you know what we did? I just read about Passover. And we took communion. What else did I know to do? Just said, we're going to do this in remembrance of you. I didn't know anything else but read the story and do that. And we sat there. It was our first Passover. The next year, I began to get the download on how Passover goes and things like that. But those of you that know, I was trained and ordained by a Messianic rabbi, so I got to sit and learn the traditions that have been handed down that I believe Paul was talking about there. And so traditionally, Passover has four cups that go along with it. And four cups on Passover, when you do Passover. These are the main elements that we're going to look at today. And there's matzah. Matzah. That's matzah. What's interesting is this matzah is a picture of Yeshua's body. And first of all, leaven is sin, and the matzah is unleavened. It means it's sinless, right? You see these stripes? One. See the stripes? Those are stripes because he was striped. These are also holes. The matzah, by rabbinic decree, has to be striped, pierced, and bruised. Do you see the bruises? And it has to be unleavened, which means it's sinless. So the matzah is sinless, striped, pierced, and bruised. This is how matzah is made. And every year at Passover, the Jewish people would sit down and they would have four cups and they would have the matzah. And it's interesting, the Jewish people came up with a tradition and they have a bag. It's called the matzah tash. Say that. In the matzah tash is three holes. One. Three pouches. Two. One, two, three. Three pouches. Three pouches. And the tradition says that you have to put unleavened bread in the pouches. So inside this is three slices of unleavened bread. And during Passover, you drink from the first cup of wine, and then you tell some stories, and then you dip your finger in the second cup, and you let out the blood for the plagues. And then the third cup, you don't touch the third cup until after the meal. Say after the meal. You break and you have the meal. And right before you break and you have the meal, the leader of the Passover Seder takes out the middle piece of matzah. Which one? The middle. And it becomes the visible image of the invisible matzah. And he brings it out. And the tradition, for some reason, we don't know why, he says, you break it. You break the matzah. Okay? And you take one half of the matzah, and you wrap it in a white cloth. And some traditions actually say you bury it. And whether it's buried under the sofa or behind a cushion, it's buried nonetheless. This piece of matzah that's hidden and brought back is called Afikomen. Say that with me. Afikomen. So you have Passover meal. You have your meal. You come back. And the tradition says that now you bring this back. Say, bring it back. So you bring this back, and then it's opened up after the meal. Say after the meal. It's opened up, and it's, wow, it's back. And then the tradition says, this isn't in the Bible, by the way. It's Holy Spirit-led, given to the Jewish people to teach us about Messiah. What's the tradition say? Next, you break a piece off. And you pass this around, and everybody breaks a piece off. And then you take the third cup, which is after the meal, and you hold it. And this cup is called redemption. Say redemption. Redemption. And it's at this time that Yeshua would have taught, this is my body given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. And this cup is the new covenant in my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, you do it to proclaim my death until I come back. As often as you do what? This. This should never be separated from Passover. It can't be. But it was, but it can't be. Because where do you get this stuff? Well, nowadays you just order it online from the Christian store and it comes broken up like this. But in the days of Polycarp, do this in remembrance of me meant once a year at Passover. You understand? And how was the cup named redemption? Figure it out. You know, Rabbi Joe said before he was a believer, they called this dessert. Because in Afikomen, the word Afikomen is very close to a word that means dessert. So they just said it was dessert. And like I said before, the Jewish people have a debate over why is there three pouches? Why is there three pouches? What are the three pieces of matzah? Well, they say, well, it's Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Well, why was Jacob pulled out of the pouch, broken in half, buried and brought back, and then eaten? Well, the other tradition says it's the three groups of people. It's the kings, the priests, and the regular people. Well, why were the priesthood brought out, broken in half, buried, brought back, and eaten? You can't explain it until you know Messiah Yeshua. And you understand that what he was saying to the disciples is, y'all have been doing this your whole life. This is me. It's me. And I can only imagine, and they eat it and drink, and I can only imagine the next year during Passover how they wept, how the Holy Spirit would have flooded them as they learned, just like the first time you did this and thought, why didn't my pastor tell me? Why have we divorced this from the whole rest of the thing? Why do we have one little cup instead of four? But it's still a Holy Spirit moment, isn't it, Richard? Some interesting research has developed to prove this tradition was around when Yeshua was here. Because there are those in the Jewish community that don't believe in Yeshua that say Christians made all this up. Like the Messian, they didn't make, let me clarify. Unbelieving Jewish rabbis say there was no messianic significance in the third cup and the piece of matzah until about 300 or 400 after Yeshua, common era. They say, oh, they just started making stuff up. Everything got messianic significance. What I'm going to prove to you is this has always had messianic significance. From before Yeshua's time, when he was here, and all the way up to now. We're not making stuff up. In 1925, an Austrian scholar named Robert Essler argued that in the time of Yeshua, the Afikomen was originally a part of the established, say, messianic ritual. So this man started studying, and he found sources that said, when they did this, before Yeshua, they were saying, when the Messiah comes, we'll know what this means. Isn't that cool? He said the whole piece of matzah held up at the beginning represented Israel, while the broken off portion stood for the long-awaited Messiah. Isn't that awesome? When the hidden Afikoma emerged from concealment, which is unwrapped from the burial cloth, so to speak. You understand what I'm saying? It symbolized the coming of the Messiah who was from the people. You understand?
Yes.
His thesis was the matzah was all Israel. The broken, hidden piece was the Messiah. And he says this symbolic ritual was already being observed in the first century as a ritual that pointed to the Messiah. Okay? People started fighting his documentation. And up until 1966, it was almost refuted. But then there's a new man, Professor David Dubai. And he's a biblical and legal scholar at Oxford University. And he revived this understanding and provided more significant documentation for the thesis. This happened in the 60s. He argued that the word Afikomen had nothing to do with dessert. What did I tell you the Jewish people say it means? Dessert. He says it comes from a verb which means the coming one or the one that's coming. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Dubai said the Passover meal long had messianic tone to it. So for a long time. The Afikomen matzah glowed with a special aura. He believed this was because it symbolized the expected Messiah. The Afikomen energized the Seder with a deep sense of expectancy. The hope of an event greater, a future Passover redemption. He found writings that said that. And then he produced them in a book. Isn't that awesome? Appropriately, this matzah was the last thing eaten at the meal. Dubai believed that the unleavened bread that Yeshua gave his disciples at the Passover meal was actually the Afikomen, which I believe that too. Don't y'all know that's what happened? I mean, what else can it be? And like even for those who say, well, he wasn't really doing Passover and he was eating fluffy bread. And I'm like, so Yeshua is saying this fluffy sinful bread is his body. And it, you know, and we just do the Passover the next day, which says the exact same, you know, has the same tones. It never made sense to me. Thus, when Yeshua lifted the unleavened bread and said, take and eat, this is my body. He was in effect saying this broken and hidden matzah, which has for our people symbolized the Messiah is fulfilled in me. This guy's writings. It's really cool. I'm the coming one that you've been expecting. So they were waiting on this. Now, this is what's really interesting, because he found in the writings of the rabbis that they said that there would be no Messiah for Israel, since they've already enjoyed him during the reign of Hezekiah, which I'm not going to get into that understanding. And in the Talmudic passage, the word enjoyed is the word for ate. So listen, Yeshua saying, eat this, even spoke to the sages of Israel, because they say that we already ate the Messiah. And so even his verb, his usage of the word eat, my flesh and stuff like that, he's talking to something so much greater than we would even know until this man brings the teaching out. You understand? It's amazing. So his Esler's and Dubai's teaching says this. Their books say this. Yeshua took an existing Jewish messianic prophetic tradition. That's a pretty good sentence. I didn't write that. It, of course, wouldn't have been that good, and it wouldn't have been spelled right. And he used it as an opportunity for self-revelation. You understand? He took this teaching that was already there, that they were saying was about the Messiah, and he said, this is about me. I think that's pretty cool. One other thing before we get to this article. There's another book that's from the first century. This is amazing. It's called The Legend of Shimon Kepha, or the book, we need a fan, the book of Peter, Simon Peter. Now listen to how cool this is. In the days of the apostles, there was a book out that was saying that these Nazarenes, all they wanted to do is mess up our Jewish stuff, because they took every feast and made it about their Messiah. And it was just a bad book. But we can look at it in our generation and say, how cool. In the days of Yeshua, there were people saying that he was born on Sukkot. We didn't make this up, family. That should make everybody happy. To me, I already know it, but when you find the resources and you find the people in that generation that say those Nazarenes were making all the feasts about their Messiah, well, why? Because it's true. Amen. Passover, unleavened bread, Sukkot, all those things. So Yeshua is here. He was born on Sukkot. He came. He's the unleavened. He's all the feasts. He taught John. John taught Polycarp. Polycarp taught, he was a bishop. He was over the fellowships. The year 160. Now, how many years? That far from Yeshua. Okay? 100 years. That means the congregations were doing all the stuff that we do here. There was no automatic Easter and Sunday. There was no communion. There was Passover once a year. Do this in remembrance of me. Then we have the Quarto Decimum controversy. We have the first split. Then from there, we have Victor, the next bishop of Rome. He rises up and he actually says, I don't like y'all guys even talking about Passover. You're kicked out. There's an excommunication, which further divides the body. Then you have Constantine, Emperor Constantine, and he raises up. And then in the year 325 is the official decree of the church. When we're going to actually make this a decree, you will not do Passover anymore. We're going to do Easter. This is their language. We have a better way from the Messiah. And everybody that does it is kicked out of the body. And not only if you do Passover instead of Easter, you're anathema from Christ. You will not be saved. You're cursed. So we would be the cursed people, according to them. And the letter says he calls them the odious Jews. You should read it sometime. So the year 325, there's the leaders, the bishops were primarily non-Jewish, and they do an official decree. That the congregations that Polycarp and Polycrates led are now diminishing into an even smaller remnant that goes underground. Why? You can't do this stuff in public anymore. Then the church, the big church, which began to be known as the universal church, which we today call the Catholic Church, because they're not doing Passover officially, what they do is they take this and this, and they say, okay, now it's not once a year, it's every time we meet. We're not doing Passover, but we have a more excellent way from our Savior called communion. And they went so crazy with it that they created a doctrine called transubstitution. And what that means is that the priest has the ability. Hey, Chris, your phone did something. The priest has the ability to take this and this and make it literally, say literally, like for real, the body and the blood. So you actually literally eat him. Well, Martin Luther didn't really like that, among other things. So when the Lutherans broke away, that was like the first break, right? So we got the Protestant Reformation, and they became the Lutherans. They still held on to Sunday, Easter, Christmas, communion, but they preached salvation by faith, by grace through faith. So they got that right. We began to come out of the Catholic Church to where we're at today. And so all the churches that were birthed from the Protestant Reformation until recent history, Sunday, Easter, Christmas, communion, nothing to do with the Jews or the feast days. That's how we got here. That's the quick story for everybody. And the Lutherans said, it's not really that. So they created a doctrine that says it's spiritually that. It can't just be a symbol. It has to actually, whatever, you know. You're still eating him. Well, look, it's a symbol. It's a symbol. We're going to talk about pastor, author, and teacher John MacArthur today. And he has an article. I don't know the man. And I do believe he's born again. Okay? So I'm going to say that up front. But we're going to read what he teaches. And it really just makes you question, like, don't you know this stuff? Yeah, Ezra's ready for me to stop. You can, I can make you a copy of this. I've highlighted things. Or you can go to this web address and read the article yourself. So he's talking about Passover. And why am I doing this? Because what he teaches is what everybody else believes. 90%. Okay, he's up here. So the article is about Passover. And he says, look at verse 14 of Luke 22. When the hour had come, he reclined at the table and his apostles with him, and he said to them, I've earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I'll never eat it until the kingdom of God. And when he had taken a cup, he gave thanks. Take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink the fruit of the vine till now, until the kingdom of God comes. And when he had taken the bread, he gave thanks and broke it. He said, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So, that's how he's beginning the article. And he says, if you wanted to title this article, he says the title would simply be The Final Passover, The First Communion. The Final Passover, The First Communion. So just at the outset, his article title makes us, after what we studied for 2 weeks, we say, it's interesting. Needless to say, he writes, this epic, this massive, this monumental, this moment in history is a turning point for all redemptive history. To put it another way, this evening, Jesus brings to an end the Old Covenant and the Old Testament and inaugurates a new covenant and a new testament. That's what they all think. Again, they're brothers in Christ. We're going to be with them, as I think, in the kingdom. Okay? Passover doesn't save us. How you understand the feasts, whether you eat pork or not, doesn't save anybody. You understand? It just shows me that most pastors don't understand the things that God's given you and feeding you, so be thankful that God's opened your eyes. I have decided, I have resolved, in my heart, I will go anywhere, 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 just to see your face. I have decided, and I have resolved, in my heart. He ends a millennia of celebration and inaugurates a new memorial. That's what they think. This passage breaks into two parts. The first part is about him celebrating Passover. The last two verses is about him instituting the Lord's table. So a simple way to outline it is the final Passover, the first communion. Remember now, the Passover, I had this conversation with my pastor. Pastor Jeffries, I love you. Remember, the Passover was instituted by God. If it is to now be eliminated, it must be eliminated by God. I used to say that. I said, God gave the Sabbath. God gave the feasts. Show me in the Bible where God changed it. Show me a prophecy in the Old Testament and a fulfillment in the New. He could never come up with that. John MacArthur is just pulling it from Luke chapter 22. But this is what they all think. They all most. Not just anybody can shut that down. Shut what down? Passover. And not just anybody can inaugurate a new memorial that we know as the Lord's table. He must do it, and they believe Jesus did it. That's what I don't understand. How can you read Polycarp? That it's a fact. Church history says he was trained by John. Church fathers knew it and wrote about it. Luke, by the way, is brief. I might add, Luke is brief. He gives us a very brief treatment of Passover. But understand this, when Luke wrote the gospel, it was 30 years later. Listen. So you have Yeshua and the 12. They have Passover. 30 years before Luke writes. Listen to what John MacArthur says. Because we know in the year 160, they were still doing Passover. But John MacArthur says, and this is, I'm bringing this to light because this is the standard, folks. This is where they're at in the church. So for 30 years, the Passover had been abrogated. Put aside, done away with. Really? That's strange. For 30 years, no one celebrated Passover. This is what he thinks. So it's not a big deal for Luke to spend much time on. It's just Passover. It's been set aside for 30 years. This is what he says. Well, the Jews were celebrating, he says, for 30 years, but they denied the Messiah, so it's just for them to have. It's like a bad attitude, too, there. So I say to myself, what about the Quarto Decimen controversy, Brother John MacArthur? So then he says, there's a monumental transition going here where Jesus ends the Old Covenant, the entire Old Covenant. He pulls the curtain down and launches something new. This is the end of the whole ceremonial law. Now again, we know, we try to like, where do you get this? They use these words. Well, that stuff is the ceremonial law. The Bible does never lay that out and separate it. So they believe that that night that Yeshua did away with, listen to the things I'm going to list. That night he did away with, and instantly everything changes. He did away with the law, the dietary law, all the Sabbath laws. In fact, there's no more Sabbath. John MacArthur. I'm quoting John MacArthur. So here's the thing. This is where the Protestants are, most of them. Everything changed that night. And this is what I was told by Pastor Jeffries, and he, a great man of God, trained me as a pastor, loved me like a son, adopted me into the family. But he said, Matthew, everything changed that night. That's what they believe. So for now on, then he says, all ceremonies, all rituals, all rites, all the social things that they did that separated them from the nations, the Israelite people from the Gentiles, that everything stopped. Except the tithe. That was switched to the pastors. They're all gone. So from here on out, we have a new feast, a new ordinance, a new supper. Okay? And that's what he teaches. So, the Lord told me specifically, I know for sure he told me last week to teach us quarto deciman. This week he said piggyback and teach us how do we go from Passover and Afikomen in the cup to communion. I just showed you. It was a change that began and was codified in 325. And today, where we're at, because the Protestant Reformation come out of the Catholic Church, we're still doing it. We will not, at this fellowship and in my house, bow to the ways and traditions of man. Amen. We are quarto deciman. We will celebrate the Passover on the 14th day of the first month, as John taught Polycarp, who taught us. I mean, as Yeshua taught John, who taught Polycarp, and as we can read in the Scriptures, that's what we're doing here. We do believe in sola fide, sola scriptura, sola Christus, sola gratia, and sola Deo glory, for God's glory on everything. Those are the five pillars of Reformed theology. I believe all that. But I also believe that Yeshua wants us to keep Sabbath and keep the feast because they're forever throughout our generations. Amen? So, I'm not telling you not to do communion in church when you're there. It's between you and God. I'm telling you that you need to ask him if you're supposed to. And then do what he says. Okay? Just do what he says.